the sensors are what give the senses to the brains that we've created in this world to help make decisions, things that you can act on. So the job that we have with that accelerometer is to make sure we only get the ones you want and ignore the ones you don't. And so what we're looking for is, as that phone moves against gravity — gravity is the thing that if you let go of the phone, it falls down — what we can do with an accelerometer is we can actually measure gravity. So we think of it for the pictures as which way is up. We're actually measuring which way is down. So that sensor in there, which we build on a computer chip, it's in a technology called microelectromechanical systems. So there's a little mass in there. It's on a spring. When you turn it up, the gravity pulls down on that spring. We can measure that motion. It's a change in the capacitance. You get two little electrodes, the gap changes. And so when I know now which way is down, then I can figure out which way to make the pictures, portrait or landscape. Now, in the case of picking up the phone, what I'm looking for is actually that sophisticated motion. And we combine the gyroscope to kind of look at that rotation. And then when you stop, we call it pose. And the question is gravity now — we measure it in three directions, so it's going to be kind of an angle — is that angle likely to be faced at someone's face? And it's not quite as simple, because if you're sitting or standing, you know what that looks like. Now imagine you're lying down on the couch. Your head may be sideways. And so that pose, and so there's a number of correct poses and the rotation that actually determines someone is probably looking at it. And probably is the word. So we have a confidence, right? And so what you're trying to do is balance that level of, let me try to make sure you always turn on when I think you're looking at it. And we don't turn on when you go in your pocket, but a few of those maybe. And sometimes you may see your phone turn on and you're like, oh, why is it so bright? Yeah, we got that one wrong. It happens. What we're doing now is we're doing it with machine learning. And so what we're able to do is we get 10 people or 20 people, and they pick up a phone and look at it. And we say, okay, pick up your phone and look at it 10 times. And we record those. And then we do it while you're walking. And then we do it while you're laying down. And we do it while you're riding in a car. And we feed all of those into, you know, a big program, that runs in the cloud, and we literally use that to teach the chip that this motion is, we call it bring to see. And these are all the things we want you to think of as bring to see.
Você vê, quanto mais inteligentes ficam os sensores, mais a gente precisa ensinar eles a medirem o que medem para poder se comportar direitinho. E falando em ensinar sensores e eles se comportarem, eu queria aproveitar para perguntar para vocês na plateia se vocês já brigaram com algum sensor, se tem algum sensor na vida de vocês que não funciona do jeito que vocês queriam.
Um sensor que eu tenho uma certa dificuldade são sensores de catracas com leitores de biometria.
Sim, sim.
Quase a gente tenta colocar o dedo e você tenta com uns, tenta com outro, tenta com outro dedo até que consegue.
Olá, eu sou o Vinícius. Eu acho que o sensor relacionado à torneira, né, de água. Ah. A gente quer estar naquela correria do dia a dia, e aí para ter essa conexão aí de ter a água, você acaba sofrendo ali com muito pouca água para poder lavar a mão, que é um custo aí para reduzir desperdício de água também, né?
Vamos ver o que o Peter Hartwell tem a dizer sobre o futuro dos sensores.
We should talk about robots, and we should talk about virtual reality and augmented reality. Because that's what's pulling me and my sensors forward. But specifically to talk about what is happening there, it's I look at our senses, and the question is, what are things that you want to digitize to help make better decisions? And so, you know, as I mentioned, we've got ears, they're microphones, we've got eyes, they're cameras. This is the one we don't have, which your nose is your, really your passive safety sense. It's your passive safety sense. If in that room where you are right now, you begin to smell smoke or something that smells warm, right? You know, think of that, right? It's your brain's going to send off an alarm. And that's something that, you know, in the bedrooms of our house, we have one smoke detector. But why is that not something we take with us wherever we go?
Yeah.
Right.
Or yeah. CO2 sensors nowadays.
Exactly. So, right. So you get into these other things you and I can't smell. Maybe a dog can smell, right? But then there's other things, that particularly the chemical place, where we think about air quality, indoor, outdoor air quality, that these are places where things that we may want to monitor just like we do with other sensors, and give you some more information about what's going on in the environment, right? And so that's the place where we've been doing a lot of research right now, so to try to bring that to a reality of being able to do local sort of environmental sensing.
Essa riqueza, esse excesso de sensores pode ser muito empolgante pelas possibilidades a serem exploradas.